Do you want to know how to treat a retinal tear with laser? Then this is the video for you. Welcome to the first video of learnabouteyes.com. In this video, we're going to look at how to treat retinal tears with laser. This video is primarily aimed at first and second year ophthalmology residents, but maybe it's interesting for other people as well. So let's not waste any more time and get started.
As with every topic, let's start with the anatomy. This is a cross-section of the eye, and I've labeled the sclera, choroid, and retina for you. But of course, the eye is not just an empty shell, it is filled with the vitreous. The vitreous isn't just water, it is a mix of water with a mesh of collagenous fibers. It has the ability to form strings and pull on things. With age, the vitreous starts to shrink, which makes it detach from the retina. Now, this is an absolutely normal aging process, but during this process, it can happen that fibers pull on the retina and tear a little hole into it. If it keeps pulling on the tear, the watery part of the vitreous can flow underneath the retina and lead to a retinal detachment. As a doctor, you're not able to avoid the tears, but you're able to prevent the tears from turning into detachments. And you're able to do that with laser. The laser actually burns the retina and fuses the retina with the underlying RPE. In order to know where to put your laser spots, you need to understand the two mechanisms that make a tear develop into a detachment. I've tried to illustrate it here with a piece of paper. First of all, if the vitreous keeps pulling on the tear, it lifts up the whole surrounding retina and enables water to flow underneath it. And if it pulls hard enough on the flap, the tear can actually enlarge. The tear will always enlarge in the same direction, along the already existing tear lines. And those lines are what you need to focus on when performing your laser. Before you start inducing laser scars in a patient, you should know your laser settings and you should know how to put on a laser contact lens. Both of these topics will be treated in separate videos and I will link them in the description below as soon as I have them. For the moment, I will just give you a little quick start guide on what settings I usually use. I usually like to start with 70 milliseconds and 150 milliwatts. The spot size depends on your contact lens. I usually use the Retina 180 lens at our clinic, which has a laser spot magnification of 1.25, so I start around 300 or 200 microns. For the contact lenses, there are basically two types of lenses. For the classic lens, you have something like a fisheye lens, which produces a very small image with distorted periphery, much like the peephole in your door at home. The mirrored lenses allow you to look around the corner for very anterior tears, and they're also great if you do some scleral indentation while performing your laser. But we're not going to get into that in this video. After you've chosen your lens, you need to figure out what laser spot magnification it has. This is usually written down in the manual, or you can find it on the internet. Then you need to put some kind of lubricant on the lens so you don't scratch the patient's cornea. There are two types of lubricants. There are cohesives and dispersives. The cohesive ones have the advantage that they stay on easily even if you turn the lens upside down. But they have the disadvantage that they can form bubbles. Dispersives, on the other hand, almost never have air bubbles. But if you have trouble putting the lens into the patient's eye, they can run off your lens before you even have it on the eye. So usually for beginners, I recommend cohesive lubricants. To put the lens on the eye, just have the patient look up, tilt the lens down, and then use the rim of the lens to push up the patient's upper lid and put it directly on the cornea. Now let's talk about where you need to put those laser spots. To illustrate this, I've drawn a little retina with a tear at the 11 o'clock position. Put your first shot close to the tear to fine-tune the settings. If nothing happens, here are a couple of tips. First, try to pull the focus back towards you until the retina is a little bit blurry, then fire again. If you have a laser effect now, adjust your eyepieces until the retina is sharp again. A lot of young doctors still accommodate pretty heavily and need to adjust their eyepieces with up to -7 diopters. If you're sure you're in the right focal plane but nothing happens, you can either increase the energy or decrease the spot size. To increase the energy, go in increments of about 10 to 20 milliwatts. And as a beginner, don't go any higher than 400 milliwatts. If you've increased the energy but nothing happens, try decreasing the spot size. I usually start at 300 microns and then go down to 200 or even 100. But please be aware, if you cut the diameter of the spot size in half, this will result in an increase of energy per area by a factor of 4. The other problem with the smaller spot size is that you just need to set a lot more spots. Once you're happy with your settings, start at the posterior rim of the tear and create one row of laser spots that are very close to each other. Try to go as far anteriorly as possible. Once you're done with that, create a second or even a third row. This is going to prevent water from flowing underneath the retina towards the posterior pole. This is the easy part. Unfortunately, that's where most beginners stop. But as we've learned before, there are two mechanisms that turn a retinal tear into detachment. We have now prevented the water from flowing underneath, but we still need to take care of those tear lines. If you don't put any laser spots anterior to the tear can enlarge and the retina can detach from behind your laser row. So try to set at least one row anterior to the tear. If you can, it's even better to put two rows. And here's a little tip, decrease the spot size for the periphery if you're using a classic ophthalmic lens because they distort and stretch the spot in the periphery. Now you need to focus on those tear lines. Put as many spots as you can and the projection of the already existing tear lines. But if you've set enough spots there, the vitreous can pull as hard as it wants. It won't be able to enlarge the tear. As a last little tip, the scars need at least 2 weeks to form, so you should monitor the patient closely during this time. Thank you so much for sticking around until the end of the video. I really appreciate it. Please subscribe to the channel and hit the bell icon if you found this interesting. I'm going to put up a lot more content just like this. If you have any suggestions on future topics or how to change the format, please let me know in the comment section down below. Thank you for watching and see you next time.